Okay, good evening, my dear students. Welcome to GradeUp, India's biggest e-learning platform. So in today's session, we'll be discussing about basis of gear trains, and most probably we'll be talking about one of the most important type of gear train, that is epicyclic gear train. Okay, so I welcome you all to this live session on the gear trains topic. Let us wait for a while so that you guys can join me, and we'll be having some animation, you will be having some understanding, more visualization of the different types of gear trains which are studied in this topic of theory of machine. Okay, and this is one of the most important and interesting topic of theory of machine, and in every examination you can definitely expect a question from this topic, which is a gear train. Okay, so very good evening, Sunil. So how are the preparations going on for all the examination? So very, very good evening all of you. So let us start this today's session. So we'll be talking about a brief discussion about gear trains, and we'll be talking about how to solve the numerical based on epicyclic gear train. Okay, so let us first discuss, let me brief about myself. My name is Suraj Gopi. I have completed my master's. I have 5+ years experience, and this is my area of expertise. So very good evening, Parth. Now let us start today's session. Now, what do you mean by gear trains? Anyone who has an idea of gear trains, what do you mean by gear trains? What is the meaning of gear trains? Gear trains is basically it's combination of different gears. It's a combination of gears is known as gear trains. Exactly, Sunil. Combination of gear is known as gear trains. Now, this is the meaning of gear trains. So, why we are using gear trains? Anyone who has an idea, what is the application of gear trains, or why we are using gear trains? We are using, the first reason why we are using is to transmit power when we need to transmit power to a large distance, large central distance, there we are using gear trains. So I can write this as, wherever we are having large central distance, there we are preferring gear trains. Now, what's the meaning of this? Long power transmission, exactly, Sunil. Wherever we need to have a long power transmission, there we are using gear trains. So what is the exact meaning of this? So let us suppose if I want to transmit power from body A to body B, which is, let us suppose it's kept a distance of 10 meter. Let us suppose like this. Okay, so if I want to transmit power along a 10 meter distance, so there are two possibilities. Either you can use two gears to transmit power from A to B. In that scenario, what will happen? You need to manufacture, you need to design two gears having large diameter. Okay, if you are manufacturing gears having larger diameter, then the cost to the material will be very high. So the cost associated for transmitting power from A to B will be very, very high. Okay, instead of that, what I can do, I can use small gears which are connected like this, so that it's the cost of power transmission is drastically reduced. Okay, so that is why we are using gear trains wherever we are having a large central distance. Okay, second important thing is, yes, anyone, what's the second application of gear trains? The first one is very important. Whenever you are having a large central distance, you are preferring gear trains. Second is basically, whenever we need to have a very high or low velocity ratio requirement. Velocity ratio requirement. Now, what do you mean by velocity ratio? What do you mean by velocity ratio? Velocity ratio is basically, it's the ratio of the RPM of the driver shaft or the driver gear to the RPM of the driven shaft. Clear? So, what is velocity ratio or speed ratio? I hope so, some of the students might be knowing about this. Speed ratio or velocity ratio, it's all the same thing. Velocity ratio, it's basically equal to omega of your main driver shaft divided by omega of main driven shaft. Now, what do you mean by velocity ratio? What is the meaning of velocity ratio? Velocity ratio means, if I'm saying, if a gear system is having a very high velocity ratio, that means the meaning of this is the velocity is dropping from 10 RPM, it is dropping from 1000 RPM to 1 RPM. That is called high velocity ratio. Fine. That means the drop is very, very high. So if you are using, for example, if you are using only two gears, let us suppose we are using only two gears, such that the velocity ratio is, let us suppose the velocity ratio is 100. If I'm saying if the velocity ratio is 100, that means the diameter ratio of these two gears should be having 100 ratio. So what will happen if you're using only two gear system? What will happen? The impact of the teeth, the impact of the bigger gear over the smaller gear, the teeth, will be very high. In short, what will happen? The smaller gear will be the teeth of the smaller gear will be broken down. Fine. So that is why whenever we require a very high velocity ratio or very low velocity ratio, in that case, instead of going into two gear system, we are preferring a gear train system. Is that clear? Fine. Instead of going to a two gear system, we are going to a gear train system. Because why? Obviously, if you are using two bigger gears, fine. If you are using a smaller gear, other to be a very big, a very large gear, so the inertia force on of gear B on gear A, the teeth will be broken down. Fine. So that is why we are preferring gear trains whenever we require a high velocity or low velocity ratio. Clear? The third most important thing is whenever we need to have a multiple velocity ratios, So whenever we require multiple velocity ratios, so we are preferring your gear trains. Okay, so these three are the applications of gear trains, and why we are using and what is the meaning of gear train? It's a combination of different gears, and this 1, 2, and 3 points are basically the why we are basically preferring gear trains over other system. So anyone who can tell me what is the practical examples of gear trains? Yes, Sunil, Latesh, Parth, what is the practical example of gear trains where we are using in daily life experience? all of you might have seen about clocks, watches, okay, toys. So in this we are using gear trains. These are the basic applications of gear trains. There's differential, so there we are using the gear trains. These are the practical applications of the gear trains. Okay, fine. The basic example which you are using in daily life is clocks or watches, hand watches. Inside you might be seeing there are a system of gears. These are known as gear trains. Clear? So now let us talk about more about the gear system. Let us suppose we are having two gears, gear number A having a radius RA, having number of teeth TA, and second gear is this one. This is your gear number B, having RB as the radius, number of teeth TB, and denoted as B. Okay, so we are having two gears in mesh. Let us suppose this gear A is rotating with omega A and gear B is rotating with omega B. Let us take a common point, which is the intersection point P. Now, what will be the velocity at point P? If I'm saying these two are gears which are in mesh, so what will be the velocity at point P? Do we have any sliding velocity in case of gear system? Or do any when the two gears are in mesh, do we have any slip velocity? Yes, anyone who can answer my question? Do we have a slip velocity or velocity of slip whenever the two gears are in mesh? Exactly, Shivam. No, that is a main important, because the gears are basically known as it's called positive drive. What is positive drive? Positive drive means we are not having any slip condition, we are having pure rolling. So what is the criteria for pure rolling? The criteria for pure rolling is, or no slip condition is, for no slip condition, your omega A into RA, should be equal to omega B into RB. which is equal to velocity at point, linear velocity at point P. Exactly, because gears are considered to be positive drive, fine, where there is no slip. Anyone who can tell me what is the example of negative drive? Can you give me the example of negative drive? Okay, gear system are basically positive drive. Anyone who can tell me what is an example of a negative drive? Negative drive basically means where we do have slip condition. That is called a negative drive. So, very best example is belt and rope pulley. Clear? In belt rope pulley, what happens? We have exactly belt pulley. What happens? We do have slip conditions. In that case, it is known as negative drive. Clear? And why we are preferring, in some cases, we are preferring belt and pulley where we can have some losses of velocity at the cost, at cost. Okay, because gear drive is assumed to be more costlier than that of belt pulley drive. Okay, fine. So, this was an introduction part of gear trains. I hope so you have understood. There are some parameters. Now, in a gear train, there are many components. Can anyone tell me what are the main components of a gear trains? Components of gear trains. What are the different components of gear trains? If I talk about the different components of gear train, what is the first component? What is the first component of a gear train? There are many components of a gear train. The first and major component is main driver. The second component is main driven. The third is intermediate your gears or idlers, and fourth is arm. So these are basically the four major components of a gear train. Clear? Fine. Now, if I talk about these three components, if you club these three components, this basically covers your simple gear trains, compounded gear trains, and riveted gear trains. Okay, is that clear? So if I talk about this, all the gear trains except epicyclic. If I talk about epicyclic, we are basically having these four. This is basically epicyclic gear train. Latesh, I want to prepare for GATE 2021, so this your scores is enough. Yes, definitely. But one thing is, you need to have practice more number of questions. Questions will be provided by GradeUp. You need to only practice by yourself. All the schedule will be given by us. You need to be disciplined on that schedule. Definitely, you will be cracking any exam. Not about GATE, you can definitely crack for ESE also. Okay, so these are the main components of our GATE trains. So let us quickly tell, there are two more definitions, that is your speed ratio. It's the speed of the driver by speed of the driven, or we can say number of teeth is of driven to number of teeth of the driver. Now, what do you mean by this? As all of you know, a concept of module. Those who have studied this gear train or gears, they might have understood the meaning of module. What is a module? Module is basically for every gear, there's a module being defined. Okay, so the module is basically the ratio of diameter of the gear divided by number of teeth of that particular gear. Okay, so module is basically diameter by total number of teeth. Now, if I'm saying two gears, gear number A, gear B, and gear C. Let us suppose three gears are in mesh. Okay. Tell me what will be the relation between the module for three gears. So today question. No, Lucky, we'll be having only theory discussion on today's session. Okay. There are three gears, A gear, B gear, and C gear. If I'm saying all the three gears are in mesh. So according to the law of gearing, it is mandatory that the module for gear A should be equal to module for gear B should be equal to module for gear C. So whenever will be having a meshing of the gear, definitely all the modules, the module for that particular gear will be equal to B, and that will be also equal to C. Why? Because A and B are in mesh and B and C are also in mesh. That means all the gears will be having the same module. Because this is very important concept, then only you will be able to solve a question from this topic. Clear? Fine. So now coming back to this, if module is C, I can add this as omega A by omega B is equal to, just now we have understood from this, I can write this as omega A by omega B is equal to RB by RA. Or else I can write this is equal to DB diameter of B by diameter of A. Okay. So if you use the expression over here, again, this is diameter B by diameter A. If I want to write in terms of number of teeth, what is module? It is D by T. So I can directly write this is equal to M of gear A. Gear A and gear B are having same module, into DB by DA. So this will be cancelled out. So in short, we can write omega A by omega B is equal to diameter for B upon diameter for A is equal to number of T's for B upon number of T's for A. Clear? So what is speed ratio? Speed ratio is the speed of the driver, speed of the driven. Now we'll be calculating for individual types of gear trains. Okay, so let us discuss what are the different types of gear trains. There are basically four different types of gear train, that is simple gear trains, your compounded gear trains, riveted gear trains, and planetary or epicyclic gear trains. And this is the most important type of gear trains, epicyclic, because we do have many applications of this epicyclic gear trains in clocks, in watches, in toys. We are basically using this type of gear train. Now how this gears looks like, so let us discuss the first type of gear train, that is called simple gear train. In simple gear train, what happens, where we'll be having different shaft, in particular shaft will be having your gears being mounted, clear, and all the gears will be connected like this from end to end. Okay, so this type of arrangement basically known as simple gear train. So if I talk about the animation part, so let us suppose gear A is basically rotating like this in an anti-clockwise fashion. In between, we are having another gear which is in mesh with gear A. So this gear is basically known as your idler. This gear is basically known as idler. Okay. Why we are using idler? Idler is basically used to change the direction. So if I say number of idler is equal to odd. Let us suppose number of idler is equal to odd. So what will happen to the direction of main driver and the main driven? Will it be same or different? Will it be same? Or if I'm using the number of idlers equal to odd, will that rotation of driver and driven will be same or not? You can check it over here. In this case, the driver is, there is a single driver. Fine. So we're having an anti-clockwise direction in the main driver, and in the driven, we do have anti-clockwise direction. That means always, whenever the number of idlers is odd, we'll be having same direction of rotation for driver and driven. Okay, and opposite to this, if we are having even number, in that case we'll be having opposite rotation of driver and driven. Clear? Now if I talk about the module, tell me, will all the gears will be same module or different module? Shubham, Lucky, Sharmila, Sunil, if these are in mesh, if the three gears are in mesh, so I can directly state that MA is equal to MB is equal to MC. That means all the gears will be same module, because all the gears are in mesh end to end. They are connected from end to end. That means all the gears will be having the same module. So I can directly write the speed ratio is equal to omega driver. In this case, driver is omega A upon omega driven is omega B. Fine. So if I look after this, the two gears A and B, for gear A and B, we're having omega A by omega B is equal to TB by TA. If I talk about B to C, we're having omega B upon omega C is equal to TC by TB. So if you multiply these two, what we'll be getting? I can write this directly as T, it will be C, speed ratio, because the driven is C. So TC upon TA. TC upon TA. Clear? So speed ratio for a simple gear train is basically either you can define in terms of angular velocity or RPM, or you can define in terms of a number of T's. If I'm defining with number of T's, then the formula will be somewhat different. Then the formula will be somewhat different. That means number of teeth in the driven divided by number of teeth of the driver. Is that clear? In the case of speed, the driver will be the numerator and the driven will be the denominator. In case of number of teeth, we'll be having driven. Why? Because just now we have understood this concept. Clear? Just now we have understood this concept. Idler gear means gear rotation not depend on intermediate gear. Yes, definitely, definitely, because why we are using idler? So that we can use excessive set of collections of your gear, so that your impact of the higher gear over the lower gear will be reduced. Clear? Now, if I talk about the second type of gear, that is called compounded gear. Now, what is compounded gear? Compounded gear is basically on one of the shaft, we'll be having more than one gear being mounted. Okay? Like if I talk about this shaft, which is coming outside the board, the gear number 2 and gear number 3 is mounted on the same shaft. So let us talk about the animation of this, because you'll be having a clear-cut idea what is happening over here. So let us suppose this is the shaft. Okay, on the same shaft, the gear number 1 and gear number 2 is mounted. Gear number 1 and gear number 2 is mounted on the same shaft. What's the meaning of this? If I'm saying on the gear number 1 and gear number 2 it's mounted, that means your omega 1 will be equal to omega 2. Jay Kishan, no, it's not important for electrical, it's basically for mechanical engineers, guys. Okay? So this type of gear in which on a single shaft more than one gear is mounted, that type of gear system is called compounded gear system. Okay? That type of gear system is called compounded gear system. Clear? So omega 1 will be equal to omega 2. Why it will be equal? Because this is mounted on the same shaft. Mounted on same shaft. Is that clear? So that is why gear number 1 and gear number 2 will be having same RPM. Clear? So in this case, if I want to calculate what is a speed ratio will be omega driver, that is omega 1. Driven is omega 3. Let us suppose this is your gear number 3. So if I compare from 1 to 2, from 1 to 2, in this case omega 1 is equal to omega 2. If I talk about 2 to 3 will be omega 2 upon omega 3 is equal to T3 by T2. Okay, so instead of omega 1, I can write omega 2, so this is equal to omega 2 by omega 3, also written as omega T3 by T2. Clear? Fine. So this is about the compounded gear. If I take the inverse of this, the train value is equal to omega 3 by omega 2. So this is the ratio inverse of your speed ratio. Now in this today's session, basically we have taken up particularly for epicyclic gear train. So let me go to the third type, which is riveted gear train. Riveted gear train, basically those type of gear arrangement in which the two gears, which the two axes which is coaxial, if I want to transmit power between two coaxial shaft, which are two different shaft, this type of gear system is called riveted gear system. In this case, if I want to transmit power from shaft 1, this is shaft 1 and this is shaft 2, both are coaxial. So this type of arrangement of gears is known as riveted gear trains. So you can see directly, gear 1 is transmitting power to 2. 2 and 3 are compounded gear trains. If you look at this diagram, so this is gear number 1, this is gear number 2, this is gear number 3, and this is gear number 4. So basically what is happening, you are transmitting power from, this is your main driver, and this is your main driven. Okay, so basically what is happening, we are transmitting power between two coaxial shaft. So If I want to transmit between two coaxial shafts, so what's in that case we'll be using the gear system, which is called riveted gear trains. Okay, fine. Now in this case, can anyone tell me which, if I'm saying module 1 is for gear 1, module 2 is for gear 2, module 3 is for gear 3, and module 4 is gear 4. So tell me which of the modules will be same. By looking at the diagram, which of the modules will be same? Will module 1 will be equal to 3, or 1 will be equal to 4, or 2 will be equal to 3, or 1 will be equal to 2? Anyone who can respond to this question, which of the gear sets will be having the same module? M1 equal to, yes, exactly, Shubham, very good. Exactly, very good. Look, gear 1 and gear 2 are in mesh. Let us suppose this gear 1, this is gear 2, this is gear 4. So gear 1 and gear 2 are in mesh. That means your M1 will be equal to M2. Fine. Gear 3 and gear 4 are in mesh. The meaning of this is M3 will be equal to M4. Fine. M3 will be equal to M4. So we can directly state that 1 and 2 are in mesh. So that is why we'll be having same module. M3 is equal to M4 because they are in mesh. That doesn't mean M1 equal to M3. That doesn't mean M1 equal to M3. Okay. Now, if I want to write a relation between the number of teeth, how can I write? If I want to write a relation between number of teeth, between T1, T2, T3, T4. So what I can write by looking at the diagram? Can I write like this? R1 plus R2 is equal to R3 plus R4. I can write, definitely I can write like this. If you see this diagram, what is R1? This is R1 and this is R2. R1. This is R3 and this is R4. So definitely, because these are basically two parallel lines, so distance between the two parallel lines will be same. So directly I can write R1 plus R2 is equal to R3 plus R4. Now, M1 is equal to R1, or I can say D1 by T1, or we can write as 2R1 by T1. So instead of R1, I can write M1 T1 by 2. Plus, instead of R2, R2 and R1 are having same module. So I can add M1 T2 by 2 is equal to M3 T3 by 2 plus M3 T4 by 2. So I can directly write this as M1 T1 plus M1 T1 plus T2 is equal to M3 T3 plus T4. I can write it like this. Fine. Now, if I'm saying all the gears having same module, if I'm assumed that all the gears are having the same module, what's the meaning of this? So meaning of this is these two modules will be cancelling out. That means T1 plus T2 is equal to T3 plus T4. Very important expression which you'll be using in all the numericals. Whenever you are solving any numerical, then definitely you will be using this application. And many of times, like 90% of the times, you'll be getting all the gears are having same modules. All gears are having same module. Are having same module. All the gears will be having the same module. So directly, we can say T1 plus T2 is equal to T3 plus T4. Clear? Last, very important, because this I was supposed to take in detail. Next is epicyclic gear trains. So what is epicyclic gear trains? If I talk about the first type was your simple gear trains. In that case, what was happening? If you're having three gears, we'll be having three different shafts and we'll be having end-to-end connection. Second type was compound gear trains. In compound gear, what happens? On a single shaft, more than one gear is mounted. Third type is riveted gear trains. Riveted gear trains basically is used for transmitting power which are between two coaxial shafts. If I talk about the fourth one, which is epicyclic gear train, in this case, one of the shafts will also be rotating. Let us see the animation of this. Now, this is a particular example of epicyclic gear trains. Now, in the center, we are having one of the gear. Okay. If I talk about this is called planet gears. Okay, if I talk about this planet gears, these are also rotating. So in this case, what is happening? This shaft is also rotating along with the gear. So whenever we are talking about any type of gear in which your shaft is also rotating along with the gear, that type of gear is called planetary or epicyclic gear train. Clear? Exactly. In this case, we'll be getting different velocity ratio, and we are also using an annular. This is called annular gear trains. Annular gear. Annular means annular gear. Annular means we'll be having inner rings. We'll be having inner teeth. That is called annular gear. Fine. So this is basically your epicyclic gear train. Now let us understand how to solve the problem when you are getting any question from epicyclic gear trains. So how to understand? Because many of time what happens, many students not able to understand what is happening in epicyclic gear train. So that is why if you talk about this diagram, many of the students what happens, they are not able to visualize it. So that is why I have given you this animation so that you can understand, you can visualize what is basically happening. So at the center, we are having one of the gear, and these two gears is connected by an arm. So this is basically the arm. This is arm. This is gear number A, this is gear number B, and this is arm C. Okay, and this gear is rotating, this gear B is rotating along, and this arm is connecting the two gears. So what is happening? This gear B is also rotating along across the circumference of this gear A. Clear? So same thing is happening over here. This red one is basically the arm, fine, and this smaller gear is rotating along with the shaft is also rotating. What is the difference between planetary and epicyclic gear? Definitely I'll be telling you. So this is your epicyclic gear trains. I'll be telling you the how you need to solve a numerical. A planetary gear train is basically what is this? We'll be having at the center a single gear which is known as sun. Okay. At the circumference of this, we'll be having a smaller gear which is known as planets. And this is your annular ring. Annular ring. And this is okay. Whenever we are using a planet and gear system, something like at the center we'll be having a sun, because what is planetary? Planetary basically means we'll be having a solar system, something like this. At the center we'll be having sun, and the surrounding will be having the planets. Same approach is given over here. At the center we'll be having sun, which is called sun gear. It is called planet gear because it's rotating around the sun gear and it is connected by an arm. Fine. And this is the annular ring. So this is known as your epicyclic or planetary gear trains. Clear? Now, how to solve the problems? Let us take a problem in this. Let us take a problem in this question. Let us suppose we are having a same arrangement which is called your epicyclic gear trains. Okay. Now, we are having gear B. We are having arm C. This is arm and this is having gear A. A number of teeth is also given. Now, in this, whenever we are solving any problem from epicyclic gear trains, yes, definitely both are same. Only difference is this is also epicyclic gear trains. Okay. But in this case, we are not having any annular ring. But in case of planetary, we need to have an annular gear. Fine. Okay. So whenever you are getting any question from epicyclic gear train, the first step is you need to draw a table. And very basic thing, very easy to draw also. First, in the first, you'll be writing arm. This is your arm C. This is gear A, gear B. Okay, so first of all, what we'll do, we'll be fixing the arm. We'll be fixing the arm. We'll fix the arm. So if I fix the arm, what is the RPM of arm C? Yes, if I'm fixing the rotation of the arm, that means it won't be able to rotate. So what will be the RPM of the or revolution of that element? That will be equal to zero because I'm fixing that arm. Definitely that will be equal to zero. Very good, Sharmila. Fine, definitely that will be equal to zero. Okay, Surabhi, Gupta, Lucky, Sunil. Yes, it will be equal to zero. Okay, now, and next, give plus one rotation or revolution to gear number A. If I give plus one rotation to gear A, this is plus one. Can you tell me what will be the rotation for gear B? If I am giving omega A is equal to plus one revolution or radian per second, what will be omega B? What will be omega B? Omega B will be, if I want to write in terms of number of teeth, so I can directly write omega B by omega A is equal to TA by TB, but with a negative sign. Why negative sign? Because if this is rotating in a clockwise fashion, so this will rotate in an anti-clockwise fashion. Okay, so I can write this as minus TA by TB, minus TA by TB, opposite direction. So we directly write minus TA by TB because omega A is directly equal to 1. Shubham, correct, but you need to apply, you need to use a negative sign also. Clear? Now, what I did, I'm giving plus x rotation to gear A. If I'm giving plus x rotation to gear, that means instead of 1, I'm giving plus x rotation. That means in that case, it will be minus x TA by TB. So this is again 0, still the arm is fixed. If I'm giving plus x, this will be minus x TA by TB. Minus TA by TB. Clear? Now, last, what I will do, I will be giving plus y rotation to all the members. If I give plus y rotation to all the members, then arm will be rotating with y. Gear A will be rotating with x plus y. And gear B will be rotating with y minus x TA by TB. Is that clear? Fine. Is that clear? If I am giving, after this, I'm giving plus y rotation is being given to all the elements. If I'm giving to all the elements, that means you have to add plus y to all the elements. Fine. Now your problem is sorted. Now in the question, they'll be giving as, let us suppose gear your A is fixed. Let us take an example. So we have framed the solution. Let us suppose in the question they are given as gear A is fixed. Gear A is fixed and your gear C is rotating or arm is rotating with an RPM of let us suppose 10 clockwise revolution. Okay, 10 clockwise revolution. You have to calculate what will be the revolution for gear number C. Yes, how to calculate? Let us suppose this question is being asked in the question in your examination. Gear A is fixed. This gear A is fixed. Okay. And arm C is given as 10 clockwise. So what's the meaning of this? If gear A is fixed, the total motion, this will be total motion y x plus y y minus x t a by t b. This is the total motion of the elements. If I'm saying gear A is fixed, the meaning of this is x plus y will be equal to 0. Definitely x plus y will be equal to 0. If x plus y is equal to 0, next statement is arm is given 10 clockwise. What is the total revolution of the arm? That is equal to y. So directly your y is equal to plus 10. If y is equal to plus 10, from this equation you will be getting x equal to minus 10. Then what is the number of revolution? Let us suppose a TA is 100 and TB is, let us suppose it's 25. Let us suppose the values of T and TB. So your number of revolution for gear number B will be equal to y minus x TA by TB. What is y? Y is 10. What is x? Plus 10. So plus 10 into TA by TB. TA by TB will be 100 by 25. So ultimately that will be equal to 50. Now, whether that will be a clockwise or counterclockwise, Tirumullai and Lucky, tell me what the final rotation which we are getting for gear C, will that be a clockwise or counterclockwise? It will be a clockwise. Why clockwise? Because we have assumed the positive value as clockwise and in the end we are getting a plus sign. That means it is a clockwise rotation for gear number your B. Okay? It's clockwise. Let us take one more example. Let us frame one more question from this. Let us take one more question so that you can easily able to understand how to solve a question from your epicyclic gear trains. Now, let us suppose arm is fixed and you are giving A gear as 30 counterclockwise rotation. Tell me what is the number of revolution for gear number B. Fine. Let us suppose arm is fixed, okay, and gear A is rotating with 30 counterclockwise. What is the number of revolutions which is making by gear B? Same approach. Now, in this case, your arm is fixed. That means your y is equal to 0, okay, and gear A is having 30. Now, what we have to write? X plus y is equal to plus 30 or minus 30. In this case, do we need to write plus 30 or minus 30 if I want to calculate this x plus y? Yes, anyone? if I'm assuming this as counterclockwise means you need to definitely go for minus 30. Very good, Tirumulai. Fine. Minus sign. Very good, Sunil. So, if y equal to 0, that means x equal to minus 30. Now, we need to get the value of or b. So, number of evolution for b is equal to y minus x ta by tb. The number of t's is exactly same. We are not changing the number of t's. So, y is 0. X is plus 30 into your, it will be 100 by 25, 34. That means 120. Now, what will be the final answer? Counterclockwise or clockwise? If I talk about the revolution for gear B, I'm getting a positive sign. The meaning of this is clockwise. Clockwise. Yes, very good. It will be a clockwise rotation. Very good, all of you. Okay, you will be getting a clockwise rotation. So, by this method, you can solve any problem. This is a thumb rule for calculating the number of revolution for an epicyclic gear train. Newton, mm, not required. If for example, if they're giving in case of radius, fine, ultimately, it will be a ratio. It will be cancelling out. Okay, no need to worry to convert into meter or mm. Fine, because ultimately we will be giving RA by RB or RB by RA. So, it will be the ratio. So, no need to convert into SI unit. For in that case, you will be getting the same answer. Okay, for planetary gears, in this case, for if I talk about planetary gears, we will be having arm. Let me name it. Same approach. We'll be having same approach. Let us suppose this is gear A, this is gear B, this is gear C, and this is arm. Let us suppose R. This is arm R. Okay. This is arm R. So we'll be having arm R, gear A, gear B, gear C. Quickly tell me, initially 0. If I'm giving plus 1 to A, what will be TB? In that case, TB will, it's connected, that means minus TA by TB. Minus CA by TB. Now, what I have to write for gear number C? Yes. What I have to write for gear number C? Because gear number C and B are internally connected. In that case, what will be the RPM of B and C? Will it be same or different rotation? The direction of rotation for gear number B and C will be same or different? It will be same because B and C are connected with internal gears. So directly I can write this is minus TA by TB into TB by TC. Is that clear? So I can write this as minus TA by TC directly because TB will be cancelling out. Fine. This is for plus 1. If I give 0 plus X, this is minus X TA by TB. This is minus X TA by TC. Last, y, x plus y, y minus x, ta by tb, y minus x, ta by tc. So, this is the total revolution of the element. And accordingly, by using the boundary condition which we are having, you can solve any problem from epicyclic, from planetary gear trains. Okay. So, this was a glimpse of gear trains, which was supposed to be discussed in today's session. Okay, so I thank you all of you for being a very good audience. And if I talk about our Vision 2021 classes, so this is batch 2 has been started by today. Today, batch 2 has launched. Basically, in this case, we'll be having 550 plus of hours of live classes like this. We'll be having an interaction like this. Okay, we'll be having live animation so that you can visualize the concept, because animations give a great impact on your imagination and you will be able to understand more clearly. Okay, we'll be having 550 plus of hours of live classes for ESC prelims paper 1 also. 700 quizzes will be there daily. You'll be getting quizzes daily. You'll be getting a quiz for your ESC level and gate level also daily, 5 question each from every topic. So it will be very beneficial for you because that will be making your concept very strong. And subject related full length mock test will be there, which will be having access at the end of the courses. So it's basically 1.5 complete course. It's for the Vision 2021 gate and ESC. If I talk about the scholarship which you can avail, you are getting a 50% off for all GATE qualified students in the year of 17, 18, 19, and 20. All IITs and IIT government students, BTEC can avail 50% discount. EAC prelims qualified students will also getting a 50% flat off. For more info, like one of the students has asked me the number, so you can go for this number or you can contact Mr. Anand Pandey. He'll be replying you, or you can go for help desk, which is help@greatup.co. Okay. Please tell me about GATE 2020 paper analysis. Definitely, Lucky, you will be getting. Those who are at the YouTube, you can switch to the our app. You can see the live classes. You can get a free, because now free live classes are been starting from today onwards. So you can definitely, you can enjoy the session from today onwards for the complete stretch of 1 week. You'll be having an access for free trial will be there. GATE qualified government college both. Yes, definitely. If you're, anyone will be availed, if you're having GATE qualified in these years, you can go for direct 50% off. If you are IIT or NIT or government college having a BTEC degree, you can go for 50%. Or if you are an ESC prelims qualified student, you can avail 50% off. Okay, clear. So thank you all for being a very good audience, for connecting me to this live session. So thank you all. And from 7 o'clock or today 9 o'clock, I suppose we'll be having one more session by more detailed about this vision will be discussed. Fine. So thank you once again for connecting with me. You can prep smart, score better with GRADE UP. Thank you and all the best. Thank you.